Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Carol Perez, and I am the Director General of the Foreign Service and Director of Global Talent here at the Department of State. It's my great pleasure to welcome all of you to the 57th Annual Foreign Affairs Day. Today is about celebrating our people, the nearly 77,000 current and former employees of the department, civil service, foreign service, locally employed staff, and eligible family members, along with our foreign service colleagues from USAID, the Departments of Commerce and Agriculture, and the U.S. Agency for Global Media. Together, we work to promote democratic values and advance a free, peaceful, and prosperous world on behalf of the American people. We all enter public service for different reasons, but for most of us, the underlying drive is a desire to make a difference and serve our country. To the retirees joining us, your contributions are still felt today and live on in hundreds of colleagues you collectively mentored, guided, and inspired. I know you still strive to have an impact. We welcome your partnership and invite you to continue making a difference. You can help us expand domestic understanding of our work and its benefit to our nation and fellow citizens. Spread the word that public service is a highly rewarding calling and recruit the next generation of capable, diverse foreign affairs professionals by seeking every opportunity to share your experiences with them. The importance of recruiting the next generation is driven home to us every day, from a global pandemic to a climate crisis, to new threats to the international order and fundamental human rights. As Secretary Blinken has noted, our challenges have never been greater, but we have an opportunity to leave behind a State Department ready to meet the test of the 21st century, an even stronger, more effective, more agile, more diverse institution that can lead America's engagement in the world. It's a worthy challenge, and one we cannot meet without your help. Please stay in touch with your colleagues in the workforce. Share your experiences as they move up and into leadership roles, and continue to serve as a mentor, sounding board, and friend. Secretary Blinken will join us later for brief remarks and also participate in a live AFSA memorial ceremony to pay tribute to those who have made the ultimate sacrifice. The Secretary, as most of you know, has had no dearth of serious foreign policy challenges to contend with over the past year. We're delighted to have Deputy Secretary Sherman talk to us later this morning about our diplomatic efforts on a range of pressing issues of vital importance to the security of the United States and our allies and partners. Thanks again for joining us today, and let's work together to inspire the next generation of diplomats and foreign affairs professionals to choose a career in service to our nation. Now, I have the honor of introducing DAC Corps President James Standridge II, who will present the DAC Corps 2022 Foreign Service Cup winner.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Jim Standridge, the president of DAC Corps. And welcome to this morning's presentation of the DAC Corps Foreign Service Cup. The criteria for the award of the DAC Corps Foreign Service Cup specifies significant post-retirement contributions in addition to a significant foreign service career. As simple as this sounds, it was more complex with Ambassador Nancy Powell. You see, you have to look carefully to reckon with a change in focus or energy between the two periods. There was no fine demarcation in the energy levels between the two periods with Ambassador Nancy Powell. Nancy retired from Foreign Service on May the 31st, 2014, after a 37-year career in which she held five ambassadorships and rose to the rank of career ambassador. She also served as Director General of the Foreign Service. her remarkable contributions to American diplomacy and her public service since retirement embodied the accomplishments which the Foreign Service Cup is intended to celebrate. Nancy served as ambassador to Uganda, Ghana, Pakistan, Nepal, and India, the latter in which she was the first female U.S. ambassador. She helped stabilize tensions between nuclear-armed India and Pakistan and contain terrorist threats emanating from Afghanistan. She served as the first national intelligence officer for South Asia on the National Intelligence Council. As avian influenza response coordinator, she led U.S. efforts to address that pandemic, for which she received the Samuel J. Heyman Service to American Medal for Homeland Security and Law Enforcement, commonly referred to as the Oscars for Public Service at that time. As Director General, she modernized hiring and career development in the Foreign Service. And she successfully met the challenge of staffing huge critical missions in Afghanistan, Pakistan, and Iraq. Now, throughout her career, Nancy championed advancement for those whom the Foreign Service had until recently marginalized, women and minorities. Following retirement, Nancy did not miss a beat in continuing to serve as mentor and model for what successful FSOs and ambassadors should be like. As class mentor for at least five ambassadorial seminars, she brought to bear her experience and insights in helping incoming ambassadors avoid the pitfalls of the job. Dozens of posts have benefited from her wisdom. Nancy was called back to the State Department in September of 2014 to coordinate U.S. efforts to combat the Ebola pandemic. Now, responding to a White House interest in consolidating international efforts to address the threat, she quickly put together what she called her ragtag interagency team and motivated them to secure international support and help our missions in Liberia, Sierra Leone, and Guinea, all to cope with the disease and the influx of assistance. Her work helped set in place muscle memory that would enable the United States to cope with subsequent pandemics, including COVID-19. Nancy helped form the Southern Delaware Alliance for Racial Justice in 2015 and led its advocacy committee for 6 years. The group organized lobbying at the state level for criminal justice reform, particularly involving eradication of juvenile criminal records. She coordinated with state agencies to set up 4 clinics which provided free fingerprinting and legal services to juvenile offenders whose records could be expunged. She served on the board of directors for 4 years, lending her active interest and support to programs that educate the program about racial justice issues. As an FSO, Nancy has embodied the values that represent the best of America, and in retirement, she lived up to George Kennan's edict that American diplomacy abroad can only be as strong as American democracy at home. Now it's my pleasure to present the DACOR Foreign Service Cup to Ambassador Nancy J. Powell. May I invite you to join me, Ambassador Powell? I'd like to read the citation on the cup, which is to my right here, to Nancy J. Powell for her dedicated service to the Department of State as a Foreign Service officer and 5-time ambassador, for her remarkable contributions to American diplomacy through modernizing hiring and career development in the Foreign Service as Director General, for championing the advancement of women and minorities who had been marginalized, for continuing in retirement to serve as a mentor and model to FSOs and ambassadors for her advocacy for racial justice that continues to this day. Congratulations, Ambassador.
President Dandridge and my friends from Decor, thank you so very, very much for this great honor. I am particularly want to acknowledge the great support that Decor has provided to the Foreign Service and the State Department over the years. And I've had a chance this morning to reflect on some of the events that I've been here, and it's been great fun to remember those and to appreciate them. I also want to thank Dick Norland, Ambassador Norland, for the nomination, for taking time out of a very busy schedule, and to his wife and sister for being here today. I very much appreciate that. It's been nice again to have good friends around. As the announcement came that I had been named the recipient of the cup this year, I had two other incidents that happened that reminded me about the service part of Foreign Service. I spent a week via Zoom with students from the University of Idaho in February. And I did some classes and we talked about South Asia, but I also did 6 hours of 15-minute sessions with individuals who were interested in the Foreign Service. And I was struck. They had a pretty good sense of the how to get into the Foreign Service, but they were very curious about my why. Why did I join the Foreign Service? And my short answer, to not use up their 15 minutes, was to say that I joined, quite honestly, for the foreign part. I really wanted to see the world, and as an Iowa school teacher, that didn't seem like it was going to happen very fast. I stayed for the service part. And I was reminded of that service part by an email that came from a young woman that I helped recruit for the Foreign Service from the Carter Center's office in Nepal. I encouraged her to take the test. She passed it. And she's now an American Citizen Services officer in Europe. And she had written to update me on how things were going, but also to remind me of just how much she was enjoying serving the American public. And as the American Citizen Services officer, I did the work in Kathmandu, Nepal, not quite in Europe, no telephone, no ATM, no email, but it was the first time that I understood the service part. It was one-on-one of helping Americans. My career took me to other places and other jobs that gave me a chance to provide service in other ways. But I have returned to being a Kathmandu vice consul. I am currently an intake volunteer for the Community Resource Center in Delaware, in my community. And I am essentially doing what I did in Kathmandu 40 years ago. I am helping people on a day-to-day basis and finding that sense of service again. I want to encourage everyone in the Foreign Service and among the retiree community to use those skills that we develop in the Foreign Service. They are immensely helpful to our communities, and they can be done within the Foreign Service community, within the State Department community, and within our larger community. I want to end by saying that when I went to my first post, I was among the vanguard of women that came in after the suit had been filed and won by a very courageous band of women. I appreciate the acknowledgement of my effort to try to improve and to recruit additional women and others to make the Foreign Service look like America. But I got to Ottawa, and most of my fellow officers were either implicit or explicit in their belief that the State Department and the Foreign Service were going to hell in a handbasket. Not only were they hiring women, they were hiring women from Iowa. Not only women from Iowa, but women from Iowa who didn't drink. Heaven forbid. I like to believe that those of us who came in that vanguard have served our country well, we've served the Foreign Service, and we have proven them wrong. And I think the efforts to expand
the Foreign Service to look like America need to continue. So thank you again so much for this award. I very much appreciate it.
An important part of Foreign Affairs Day is honoring and thanking our retired colleagues, both civil service and foreign service, for their contributions. I am delighted today to recognize two individuals whose careers have left an indelible mark on the department and our nation. First, I am pleased to present the Director General's Civil Service Cup to John Robinson. John's distinguished career of service began five decades ago in Vietnam, where he served as a naval officer aboard a destroyer and an ammunition ship. His courageous conduct there earned him the Navy Commendation Medal. It was an auspicious start. One of the remarkable things about John's accomplished career is just how varied it has been. John was not wedded to a single agency. He sought opportunities to help others, and he followed his heart. This would take him from the halls of Brown University, where he served as a dean and administrator, to the halls of power in Washington. In the early 90s, before joining the Federal Service, John served in the Rhode Island Governor's Cabinet as director of the Department of Employment and Training. Many of the issues he encountered there, issues of equal opportunity, and equal access and labor rights, would become major themes throughout his federal career, from his early days as Deputy Assistant Secretary in the Employment and Training Administration of the Department of Labor to his role as Senior Policy Advisor to the Secretary of Energy, fighting for workplace improvements and helping the Department of Energy recruit a more diverse workforce and create a more worker-friendly environment, all in partnership with DOE chapters of the National Treasury Employees Union. John would go on to serve as the first chief of EEO and diversity for the Office of the Director of National Intelligence, and occupied a similar role for the Internal Revenue Service from 2001 to 2005. When I met him, John was Director of the Office of Civil Rights and Chief Diversity Officer for the Department of State, a position to which he'd been appointed in March of 2008. He served as primary advisor to the Secretary of State on EEO issues, diversity and inclusion, and affirmative employment. A longtime colleague said of John's vision and leadership at the department, John knew that the Office of Civil Rights would never succeed in its mission if its only function was one of enforcement. So he ensured his staff conveyed the righteousness of their cause, that treating everyone with dignity and respect was not just the right thing to do, it was also the smart thing to do. Marginalizing anyone because of their race, creed, color, national origin, or physical characteristics was not only illegal and immoral, but also poor management. John insisted that everyone had a contribution to make, and not taking advantage of everyone's contribution undermined the national security mission of the State Department. As Director General, as a management officer, and a citizen, I have nothing but the most profound respect and appreciation for the work John has dedicated his life to, and it gives me great pleasure to be able to present him the 2022 Civil Service Cup for 25 years of distinguished service with the Department of State and other agencies, and his enduring commitment to knowledge sharing and mentoring that has continued to have a positive impact on the department as a whole. Congratulations, John. Thank you for the dedication and inspiring leadership you display throughout your career.
Congratulations.
Thank you very much. Good morning, and thank you for tuning in today. After retiring in the spring of 2017, my wife Sylvia and I traveled a bit pre-COVID, and we built a new house and eventually relocated to North Carolina. Our next step was to be landscaping, and then I saw a call coming in from the DG's number, and I began having flashbacks about emergency meetings and short fuse papers. I answered the call to receive the news of my selection for this honor, and I'm very grateful to be recognized with the DG's Cuff today, along with my esteemed colleague, Ambassador Kennedy. Now, I've held some interesting jobs during my career. Labor researcher, surface warfare, naval officer, college dean, to name a few. I used to describe being dean of students at Brown University as playing straight man to 5,000 drunken comedians. Talk about flashbacks. Except for one, none of my previous positions brought me into a conflict zone, though. One of the highlights of my career at State came in my trip to Baghdad around the time that ISIS had closed within 100 miles of the Iraqi capital. I recognized the danger posed by heading into a war zone, and people might understandably have wondered, especially my wife and children, why I needed to go to the embassy myself at this perilous moment, going to address serious concerns about the protection of our officers' civil rights. The reasons were very clear to me. First, I wouldn't send any member of my staff to any place I wasn't willing to go myself. And secondly, the values that we espouse must be upheld when nerves are strained the most. Leadership means setting an example, and leaders at this department know that better than most. But the role of which I'm most proud is dad. There's no retirement from that plan. We raised four terrific kids, all educated, employed, and tax-paying property owners. A Fulbright scholar, now 3 years at State, a registered nurse, just finished her master's degree in nursing practice, a network security engineer working abroad, and a bilingual school psychologist. Our kids were a tremendous source of pride for me and Sylvia. And we paid a lot of tuition. I want you to know that my service at State was indeed a privilege and an honor. I served under three secretaries, Rice, who selected me, Clinton and Kerry. Each had their impact, but an EEO chief can do very little unless backed up by a committed cadre of senior officers. It was not a matter of reporting up the line. Rather, it was reaching out to and being supported by you. Ambassadors, chiefs of missions, directors, senior foreign service officers, senior executives, department heads, acting, thises and thats, and whoever needed to take charge. It was also an honor because I had immense help, recruited and encouraged by Ambassador Pat Kennedy. I was proofread and often corrected by my successor, Greg Smith, who was ably backstopped by Glenn Budd, an infinitely practical former heavy equipment operator and a DOD EEO superstar, now Greg's deputy, senior foreign service officer Audrey Dumontat. She coached me on foreign service culture, and we do need coaching. And so many other officers who lived out their oaths of office at SOCR during my tenure. The oath, that's where it all starts. I, John Robinson, do solemnly swear, and I will protect and defend the Constitution of the United States against all enemies, foreign and domestic, and I will bear true faith and allegiance to the same. It goes on. Nearly identical to the oath sworn by George Washington, I took that pledge as a 22-year-old ensign during Vietnam, again at Labor, Energy, IRS, the Office of the Director of National Intelligence, USAID, and finally at State, 7 times in all. And each time we take that oath, we reaffirm the commitment to a set of values given life by people of conscience and character every day. So I salute you, and I thank you for the individual and collective ways in which you help to embody those values by advancing diversity, equity, and inclusion at State during my tenure, and for continuing that work today. It has been my privilege and honor to share your commitment to honesty and excellence, and for that, I am profoundly grateful. Thank you.
It is now my pleasure to present the Director General's Foreign Service Cup for 2022 to Ambassador Patrick Kennedy. Few people have had as profound an impact on the department as an institution in the last half century as Ambassador Patrick Kennedy, or Pat as he is known to most of us. From his early days as what was then called a rover, an administrative coned officer, to the ranks of the Senior Foreign Service, and the role of Undersecretary for Management, a position he held for 10 years under three different secretaries of state and two different presidents. Ambassador Kennedy has singularly focused on ensuring the department empowers our people so we can deliver for the American people. Along the way, Ambassador Kennedy served in Paris, Cairo, and various domestic assignments. An early stint as special assistant in the office of the Undersecretary for Management unearthed his true passion: innovation and institutional reform in the interest of taking care of our people and delivering on our mission. This is what drove him later in senior administrative roles as Assistant Secretary for Administration, Acting Assistant Secretary for Diplomatic Security, Coordinator for the Reorganization of the Foreign Affairs Agencies, and U.S. Representative to the United Nations for Management and Reform with the rank of Ambassador. Pat played an instrumental role in some of the most challenging operations the department and the country undertook following September 11. In 2003, he helped establish the U.S. presence in Iraq as Chief of Staff of the Coalition Provisional Authority. Later, in 2004, as Chief of Staff of the Transition Unit in Iraq, he helped transfer sovereignty to a newly installed Iraqi government that was more representative of and responsive to its people. Never one to shrink before even gargantuan challenges, Ambassador Kennedy returned to Washington and from February 2005 to April 2005, headed the transition team that set up the newly established Office of the Director of National Intelligence. He then served as the Deputy Director of National Intelligence for Management until May of 2007. Now, fortunately for us, Ambassador Kennedy made his way back to the department and was confirmed by the Senate as Undersecretary for Management on November 6, 2007, a position in which he served until January 27th of 2017. Diplomats are not given to using adjectives like indispensable to describe their colleagues, but with Pat, it's more than appropriate. Three very different Secretaries of State, Secretaries Rice, Clinton, and Kerry, knew that whatever the crisis, whatever the operational challenge, the management of the department was in the most capable hands. More than that, they knew he cared. He cared about the welfare of our workforce and their families. He cared about being a responsible steward of taxpayer dollars. And he cared about maximizing department resources and ensuring their effective use on behalf of our country and the American people. This combination of competence and care allowed the department to weather many a Washington budget storm during his tenure without having to furlough employees or resort to extreme cuts. In a business in which senior leaders are often hardened by grueling schedules, relentless demands, and unfair criticism, Pat's distinguishing characteristic was always his limitless compassion and accessibility. He mentored junior employees, both foreign and civil service. He answered their questions, and he offered guidance, often meeting with mentees over a jar of pretzels after a long day. To quote a longtime colleague and friend, "The most impressive and inspiring aspect of working with Pat Kennedy was his never-ending endeavor to find a way to take care of people, to make things work, and to make the department stronger. He was, and still is, a mentor, a friend, someone from whom many of us still seek wisdom." I know this to be true. I also know that Pat is always ready, willing, and able to give back. Though he retired in 2017, last year, when the department needed him, he didn't hesitate. He was recalled to duty to serve as Senior Advisor for United Nations Management and Reform at the U.S. Mission to the UN in New York City until the end of December, during a period when the nominee for U.S. Representative was awaiting confirmation. Pat also serves on the boards of the American College of National Security Leaders and the American Academy of Diplomacy. He is a fellow of the National Academy of Public Administration, a member of the American Academy of Diplomacy, and a sage at the Partnership for Public Service. It is my great privilege to present the Director General's Foreign Service Cup to a mentor, friend, and role model, Ambassador Patrick Kennedy. in recognition of more than four decades of distinguished service with the United States Department of State. You are an inspiration to scores of civil and foreign service colleagues you have mentored and guided.
I am very, very honored to be the recipient of the DG's Foreign Service Cup. In the presence of my good friend, John Robinson, congratulations, John, and to join the company of Larry Eagleburger and my four-time former boss, John Negroponte. I'm also more than a little surprised, since in the half century of this award, only two other management officers have ever been its recipient. So to join Joan Clark and Mary Ryan is very special. I accept this award fully aware that I must gladly share its receipt with an untold number of colleagues who have enabled me to accomplish whatever acts I am being credited with. Long before the concept of team became government and corporate lingo, the department's administrative management, consular, medical, and security professionals knew and acted on the principle that their vital support functions could only be accomplished by working together. Each knew that only as a team could the American people have the national security support they required. I was fortunate to have bosses like Kreisa, Moose, and Reed, and later Levitsky, Roy, and Pelletreau. Secretary Schultz and Baker, Christopher and Rice, Clinton and Kerry all gave me the opportunity to try new approaches. Their blessing and the incredible work every day of all of those I was lucky enough to have as direct reports in both A and M have led to a wide range of projects, Fort Lauderdale and Frankfurt regional centers, consular centers in Kentucky and South Carolina, joined in the latter by finance and human resource operations, a permanent mail facility at Dulles Airport, State Department owned facilities on Navy Hill, a portion of the former Red Cross building, a permanent residence for the United Nations Ambassador, the Colorado IT Center, and a second International Chancery Center, the Diplomatic Security Training Headquarters, and its office headquarters, a new wing at FSI, rehabilitation of the old State Wing, Foggy Bottom, and a partial overhaul of New State, expanded child care capacity, a single leased home for consular affairs, ICAS and capital security cost sharing, ILMS and a new FMS, green energy and water recycling, 150 new payroll systems for locally employed staff, IVG connections to every post overseas, and then high-speed lines, the State Department Air Wing for crisis support, extensive use of the Student Loan Repayment Program, and the establishment of the Foreign Service Family Member Reserve Corps. Dayton and Wye River, among many other conferences, avoiding the layoffs of State Department personnel during shutdowns and the merger of State, USA, and ACTA, and numerous evacuations. I am privileged to have been associated with all these efforts and many others, but the credit is definitely not all mine. It goes to my deputies and to others, little known but also outstanding professionals, such as Brendan and Hartman, Moser and Wifter, Mulvey, Boswell and Starr, Tagliatella and Lussier, Deering, Sinajitz and Carter, Jarek, Hawkins, Green and Billette, Eaton and Hughes, Miller and Grayfield, Whiting and Van Dyke, Stever and Reed, Del Judas and Devlin, Nolo and Sitter, Coates and McLaughlin, Dent and Bordley, Hodges and Hathaway, Bull and Wills, Sprague and Seagroves, Rapash and Hughes. And I will stop there because I know I've gone on too long. And I know that I should have singled out many, many more colleagues, civil service, and foreign national, who contributed so much. I will only add Washington, Bisbee, Phipps, Adams, Fulton, and Helton Floyd, and an exceptional corps of special assistants, both groups putting me up with me over many long hours. And particularly Kathleen Austin Ferguson, who worked for me twice, despite her unfailing, accurate judgment on all other decisions. And though never part of the family directly, the best lawyers in Washington, led by Momberg, Selby, Thessen, and Visick, who took wild ideas and fitted them to legal reality. In sum,
a multi-talented, extremely competent, and very dedicated core of enablers who constantly delivered what the department needed and will continue to do so in the future, even if they receive so little appreciation and recognition. It was my honor to be associated with them. Thus, this award is as much theirs as it can ever be mine. Lastly, I want to thank my wife, Betty Swope, who put up with me on many, many separations and all too often phone calls in the middle of the night and on weekends. Thank you very, very much, Director General Perez.
I'm Eric Rubin, President of the American Foreign Service Association, AFSA. Thank you for joining us to watch the proceedings as we commemorate this year's Foreign Service Day. This event is a highlight of our year. While I wish we were meeting in person, I'm thrilled nonetheless that we can join together virtually to celebrate the contributions of the United States Foreign Service and our civil service colleagues. Today is a solemn day for us at AFSA. We use the occasion of Foreign Service Day to honor our fallen, those who have given their lives in service to our country. There are now 351 names etched into the new AFSA memorial plaques in the State Department C Street lobby. I encourage you to pay your respects the next time you're here, hopefully at next year's Foreign Service Day event. As AFSA prepares for its centennial in 2024, we share our birth year with the United States Foreign Service itself. I hope you remain a member and a steadfast supporter of your union and professional association. Our main focus is and always has been member service. We are here for you from the beginning of your career through retirement. If your AFSA membership has lapsed for any reason, I hope you will consider joining or rejoining. AFSA membership in retirement has many benefits, from the Foreign Service Journal to our hugely popular Daily Media Digest, access to a dedicated retiree counselor, AFSA advocacy on retiree benefits, and so much more. We are the voice of the United States Foreign Service, and we speak more effectively and more loudly when we have everyone behind us. Most of all, we are proud to represent you, the members of the United States Foreign Service. I wish you a very happy Foreign Service Day. I hope you enjoy the presentations, and please do watch the memorial commemoration. And let's all agree to meet in person next year. Thank you for joining us.
Hi, I'm John Bradshaw, Executive Director of DACOR. We are very pleased to be co-hosts of Foreign Affairs Day today and to present the Foreign Service Cup during today's program. DACOR is an organization of foreign affairs professionals, not only foreign service officers, but civil service officers, all kinds of foreign affairs professionals, whether academics, journalists, development specialists, former Peace Corps volunteers, anyone who is a foreign affairs professional. And we have opened our membership over the years. It used to be, as you may know, just retired foreign service officers, but now it's a very broad and welcoming membership. DACOR holds programs of all types, lectures and other programs. We have lots of activities here, receptions, social activities. We have a lot of camaraderie, and people, our members really enjoy the time they spend here at the house, both learning and experiencing friendship. We also give out over $250,000 worth of scholarships every year, so we also have that aspect. As far as becoming a member, all you have to do is go onto our website and look at, you'll see it's docorbacon.org, and you'll see membership materials, very easy to figure out the eligibility, and I believe most of you that are watching today are eligible. Even if you don't live in the United States, you can be, or in Washington, you can be a non-resident member, and then you can watch our programs online. You can stay here at the house when you're in Washington. We have three beautiful guest rooms here. And you can also enjoy privileges with reciprocal clubs that we have all over the world on almost every continent and all across the United States. So our non-resident members really enjoy that aspect of our organization. The house here where DACOR is base is the historic DACOR Bacon House, which will be 200 years old in 2025, built in 1825. This house has so much rich history. We love looking at the history here. All the presidents and politicians and celebrities for many years have been in this house. We have been doing a lot of looking into the archives of the house and figuring out the history. We have a historian who's written much about it, and it's a very rich history. This house was the number two social event space in all of Washington after the White House during the 19th century. So we encourage you to think about becoming a member of DocCorps. Again, going to our website, docorbacon.org, where you can find the membership materials very easily. They're very prominently displayed on our web home page for the website. We'd love to welcome you all here anytime that you're in DC, whether you're a member or not. Please come by and see us and enjoy this beautiful treasure, this gem right here in downtown DC, two blocks from the White House and two blocks from the State Department. So again, we are very pleased to be hosting this day, co-hosting this day for all of our Foreign Service and Civil Service colleagues, and we wish you all the best and hope to see you here in the House someday soon. Thank you.
Good morning. Welcome home to all, even though we are once again totally virtual. My name is Paula Jacob, and I'm the Executive Director of the Senior Living Foundation, and I am so pleased to be with you today. The last 2 years have been rough, filled with uncertainty, stress, and even fear. Many of us suffered afflictions directly due to COVID, indirectly in normal healthcare issues that we are now contending with due to delayed treatments. More than half of us probably suffered from the emotional strain of isolation. Things were just plain hard, but it looks like we are coming through it, and there is indeed light at the end of the tunnel. Good for us, but not so easy for many of our colleagues who turned to the Senior Living Foundation for help. Over the last 2 years, the foundation has provided close to $1.5 million in support. Beyond the hundreds of hours of home health care that we already provide our grantees, we stepped in to pay for additional hours when local and state level agencies suspended their services. More than a dozen widows turned to us for emergency financial support while waiting their survivor annuities, and we responded in more than $50,000 in total support. When our colleagues were not able to leave their homes and did not have the same level of support, we started a partnership with Mom's Meals to deliver nutritious, easy-to-heat food while they were in isolation. Our clients received more than 12,000 meals since March of 2020. Let me share with you just a few stories to demonstrate the unique ways the foundation responds to our colleagues. The sister of a retired Foreign Service officer who lived overseas contacted us for guidance as the families made plans to bring the retiree back to the States. The retiree was currently in a psychiatric hospital, and the family in the U.S. were concerned that she was not receiving the right care, and she was also vulnerable for financial exploitation. The foundation provided resource information regarding transportation to the U.S. and also affordable housing near care near the facility. The foundation coordinated with the Foreign Service Benefit Plan, who leveraged an existing relationship in that country to obtain the necessary documentation for claims, to facilitate nurse care manager updates, and to send somebody in to check on the retiree. Due to our intervention that was critical in ensuring the proper care and discharge, the retiree is now living in the U.S. near her family. One more story. In December of 2020, we received a call from a recent widow who had just learned that her survivor annuity payments would be delayed by months. We stepped in, we started sending her emergency grants for about 3 months. And when she finally did get her survivor annuity, it was much less than she expected. never having turned away a qualifying colleague in need, we began a monthly grant, and we continue to help this colleague with basic living expenses. Our commitment to this widow, like all of our other grant recipients, is for life. So these are hopefully warms your heart. Thanks to you, you know, and you know who you are, we are able to provide these vital services and support to people who need them the most when they need them. Thanks to you, we are indeed making a positive difference in so many lives. I hope you enjoy your day of education and celebration, and also understand your contributions to your country. But before that starts, please take a moment to reflect on how you contribute to your colleagues by helping the Senior Living Foundation take care of our own. Thank you again so much for your support of our mission, and I sincerely hope to see you all in person next year.
It is now my distinct privilege to introduce the 21st and first female Deputy Secretary of State, Wendy Sherman. Deputy Sherman was confirmed on April 14th, 2021. She is well known to our audience and department family from her tenure as Undersecretary for Political Affairs from 2011 to 2015 and earlier service as Consular to Secretary Madeleine Albright and Special Advisor to President Clinton and Policy Coordinator on North Korea. Madam Deputy Secretary, over to you.
Hello, and welcome to the 57th Annual Celebration of Foreign Affairs Day. I only wish I could be with you in person, but as this group will appreciate better than most, duty called, and I'm on official travel today in Gabon. Shortly after being sworn in, President Biden visited the Harry S. Truman Building and pledged to put diplomacy back at the center of America's foreign policy. That means we're putting in the time to rebuild, strengthen, and grow our network of alliances and partnerships, from reinforcing the ironclad NATO alliance to affirming ASEAN centrality, to elevating the Indo-Pacific Quad, to deepening our work with partners in Latin America and Africa. It means we're working to address the challenges of this century, donating more COVID-19 vaccine doses than any other nation, rallying the world to take on the climate crisis and build more clean energy, and working to make sure the internet remains open and secure. And it means we're leading with our values, our belief in democracy, in freedom of expression, in a free and vibrant press, our commitment to universal human rights, our support for free enterprise and building shared economic prosperity, and our understanding that the best way to advance all those values, and in turn, to advance America's interests around the world, is by upholding and strengthening the rules-based international order that has made peace and prosperity around the world for more than seven decades. We are seeing President Biden and Secretary Blinken's approach pay off in real time right now. No matter how strong any one nation's military may be, or how vibrant its economy, or how creative its people, no nation can solve the challenges we face today on its own. America's alliances and partnerships are our greatest strength on the world stage. And our work since day one of the Biden-Harris administration to invest in those alliances and partnerships laid the groundwork for the overwhelmingly united global response to Vladimir Putin's premeditated, unprovoked, unjustified, and utterly horrific war against Ukraine. Together with our allies and partners, we have surged defensive assistance and humanitarian aid to Ukraine and to its people as they bravely fight to defend their homeland, their sovereignty, and their future. We have imposed unprecedented coordinated sanctions and export controls on Putin and on his enablers. 141 nations stood together at the UN to oppose Putin's war, and just four voted with Russia. That's because nations around the world recognize that a threat to the rules-based international order anywhere undermines it everywhere. And when autocrats like Putin believe they can violate another nation's sovereignty and territorial integrity with impunity, when they believe the principles enshrined in the UN Charter do not apply to them, when they believe they can rewrite history for their own aims and spread disinformation around the world to support their perverse goals, that makes us all less secure. In recent months, we lost two giants of diplomacy who knew all too well and all too personally what's at stake in the world right now. Secretary Colin Powell, who passed away last fall, and my dear friend, Secretary Madeleine Albright, who died at the end of March. Secretary Powell loved and admired the State Department and its people, and all of us have benefited from his work to modernize American diplomacy. Secretary Blinken is carrying that legacy forward with his own modernization agenda, introducing new telework flexibilities, prioritizing diversity, equity, inclusion, and accessibility, and investing in building the expertise we need to tackle 21st century challenges like cyber and digital technology and the climate crisis. Having seen the alternative with her own eyes, Secretary Albright was a fierce advocate for democracy and democratic freedoms. She loved America, the country that took her and her family in as refugees when she was just 11 years old. Loves America with all her heart. She often called the United States the indispensable nation in world affairs, not as a jingoistic boast, but because she believed in America's ability to rally the democratic world in common cause and to fight back against tyrants, authoritarians, and repressive strongmen. I know that is a mission that you all believe in as members of our foreign affairs family. So on this Foreign Affairs Day, I thank you for all you have done and all you are still doing to serve the American people, to advance our nation's values and vision, and to make our world more peaceful, prosperous, and free for future generations. Thank you, and happy Foreign Affairs Day.
Good afternoon. My name is Eric Rubin, and I'm the president of the American Foreign Service Association. It is my distinct pleasure to stand alongside Deputy Secretary McKeown this Foreign Service Day as we honor the achievements and sacrifices of the entire foreign affairs community. We wish Secretary Blinken a speedy recovery and regret that he cannot join us today. For nearly a century, it has been AFSA's privilege to keep and maintain this memorial to the courage of the United States Foreign Service. Since 1933, we have gathered before these plaques to commemorate our fallen colleagues who now number over 300. Despite the difficulties presented by the ongoing global pandemic and the impersonal nature of these virtual proceedings, I am very glad that we've been able to keep this tradition through these challenging times. This year, members of the United States Foreign Service faced unprecedented global challenges, some new, others enduring. Our members have been on the front lines of the outbreak of war in Europe, the increasingly disastrous effects of climate change, and assaults on our democratic values both at home and abroad. We count ourselves especially fortunate then to be adding no new names to these walls today. Today, it is with great pleasure that I can say that none of our Foreign Service colleagues were killed or lost their lives in service to our country in the last year. Nevertheless, service carries significant risk, and our happiness today is tempered by the announcement of a new memorial to be constructed here in coming months. AFSA and the Department of State will soon unveil a bronze plaque commemorating those in the foreign affairs community who lost their lives due to COVID-19. Unfortunately, deaths due to COVID-19 do not qualify for inscription on the traditional AFSA memorial plaques. Nevertheless, we sought to honor those who lost their lives after contracting the virus while serving overseas. Several of those in the Foreign Service community succumbed after developing COVID-19 at their post of assignment. Alongside several locally employed staff, Foreign Service family members, and others, two Foreign Service officers, Elbridge Lee of Embassy New Delhi and Thomas Wallace of Embassy Lima, lost their lives to this ongoing pandemic. Finally, I want to mention another plaque that can be found here in the C Street lobby. Since the year 2000, we have honored fallen Foreign Service family members with a special plaque sponsored by AFSA and the Associates of the American Foreign Service Worldwide, AAFSW. Their service and sacrifice are just as important for us to keep in mind today, and I hope you'll pay your respects the next time you pass through these halls. For their valiant and determined commitment to the United States and its citizens, those inscribed here deserve our utmost respect and admiration. Thank you all for joining us here today as we pay tribute to those who lost their lives in service to our country. Each year we gather here in solemn silence as a community to pay our respects and to honor our fallen colleagues. In this tradition, we also ask American embassies and consulates around the world to participate in their own moments of silence, from Albania to Zimbabwe. This year, we are honored by the participation of Foreign Service posts in Quito, Nairobi, Baku, Warsaw, Port Louis, Reykjavik, Canberra, and dozens of others. Now, if you would please join me and our colleagues around the globe in observing a moment of silence, followed by our national anthem. Thank you. Each name chiseled on these walls represents one of our fellow public servants, fellow diplomats, and fellow Americans whose lives were lost in service of a greater purpose. Each time we pass through these halls, they continue to serve as they remind us to execute our own duties with that same purpose and dignity, to ensure the strength of our mission and to memorialize those who have come before us. It is now my pleasure and distinct honor to introduce the Deputy Secretary of State for Management and Resources, Brian McKeown.
Thank you very much, Eric, and thank you for your leadership of the American Foreign Service Association. I wish we could gather in person and hope we can do so next year. But I want to welcome everybody who's joining near and far. Thank you also to our other co-sponsors of the 57th Annual Foreign Affairs Day, DECOR, as well as the Senior Living Foundation. It's a distinct honor for me to be here with you today. The Secretary of State sends his regrets that he couldn't be here to join us for this. And as Eric mentioned, and you no doubt saw in the press, he's tested positive for COVID-19. He's currently working from home for a few days. I'm pleased to report that I understand his symptoms are mild, and we all wish him a speedy recovery. Today is an opportunity to honor the thousands of diplomats, development experts, and other professionals who have represented the United States at home and around the world. It's also a day to honor specific individuals, recipients of the DECOR Foreign Service Cup, the DG Foreign Service Cup, and the DG Civil Service Cup. So I want to congratulate Ambassador Nancy Powell, Ambassador Pat Kennedy, and former Director of the Office of Civil Rights, John Robinson. Thank you for all that you have done and continue to do on behalf of the Department and the American people. To all of you joining us from around the world, whether you served previously or currently serve, at the State Department, at USAID, the Foreign Agricultural Service, the Foreign Commercial Service, or the U.S. Agency for Global Media, I want you to know, the Secretary wants you to know, how grateful we are for your work. I'm relatively new to the State Department, but I've had 30 years of experience in the federal government, and I've had the honor of working alongside and with hundreds of talented foreign affairs professionals from the State Department and all the agencies represented here today. This includes the retiring classes of 2019, 2020, and 2021, whom we've not had the chance to celebrate in person due to the pandemic. Through decades of service in ways large and small, the members of these retiring classes did work that matters, work that was elemental to building a safer, more stable, and more prosperous world. Like the generations of foreign affairs professionals that preceded them, this cohort also worked to strengthen the rules-based international order that undergirds stability and prosperity for the United States, as well as people around the world. The past few months have shown us precisely why we cannot take that order for granted, and why American leadership and American diplomacy is needed more than ever. When it became clear to the United States that Russia was planning to further invade Ukraine, the United States mobilized allies and partners for a collective response, imposing crippling economic and financial sanctions, restricting the export of critical technologies to Russia, isolating the Russian Federation diplomatically with a historic vote at the General Assembly, condemning Russia's actions, suspending it from the UN Human Rights Council, and even its observer status at the Organization of American States. We've also led the world in marshaling the resources to provide substantial military and economic assistance to the brave people of Ukraine resisting Russia's aggression, and so much more. The unity of our European and Asian partners did not happen by accident. It occurred in no small part because of determined diplomacy by the United States. You should all be proud of the foreign affairs professionals of this department and across the government for the work that they have done night and day since last fall, here and at overseas posts to organize this effort. We do this work because it matters, because we seek to serve our fellow citizens and in a mission larger than ourselves. It is work that requires sacrifice and commitment. All of you worked long hours under tight deadlines and serious pressure, sometimes in difficult and dangerous circumstances, because that's what the mission required. You gave up family events, from birthdays to weddings to funerals, living halfway around the world to serve the American people. Your family sacrificed too, because they understood that you were doing work that mattered. The names on this memorial wall in this lobby remind us, every time we walk through it, that some of our colleagues, over 300, have made the ultimate sacrifice. For many of you, your service did not end with your time in government. Many of you stepped up last fall to help resettle Afghan refugees. Many of you are rallying now to support Ukrainians, both those being forced to flee and those bravely defending their country. Others of you continue to give back as volunteers at places of worship, community organizations, after-school programs, to name just a few. And others are mentoring current and future diplomats. If I can make one final request of you, as Deputy Secretary, but as a fellow American, it is this. Please stay engaged. You still have an important job, the most important job of every American citizen. We've been reminded that our experiment in self-government is not a birthright, but something every generation must protect and defend. So please continue sharing your stories, spreading the message that diplomacy matters, especially for the greatest problems before us. And please keep mentoring and helping us to recruit the next generation of diplomats. They need you, we need you. So thank you, everybody, for your past service and for all that you continue to do on behalf of the American people.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Secretary, for those meaningful remarks and for joining us this year and for your continued dedication to the men and the women of the Foreign Service. I'd like to express my heartfelt thanks to everyone who's joining us today, both in person and virtually. AFSA and all of us appreciate your taking the time today to honor our colleagues on this important occasion. This concludes today's ceremony. Thank you again for joining us.